extremely happy to welcome one of China's most well-known, one of China's best contemporary writers. And absolutely knowing that to write in China today is not that easy. Think of what happened to Liu Xiaobo and his tragic death just a couple of months ago. And think also of the fact that those who tried to commemorate him, people like the poet Langzi, are now languishing in jail. So we're extremely happy that tonight we can talk with Yu Hua, and I'm sure, as you're so numerous, as it is a full house, that you must have read his books, and that you're familiar with his tragicomical style, in which he always brings characters that at once have to go to their own funeral without even having relatives to attend, as is the case in The Seventh Day. And of course, four books have been translated into Dutch, and even more have been translated into French. And for those of you who would like to pick up a copy, a signed copy, there will be a possibility for that afterwards. But I'd like you to suggest, that Yu Hua starts with reading a small excerpt from a book that has been translated into French, has not been, unfortunately, translated into Dutch, and that is called China in 10 Words. Mr. Yu, could you read a part for us? Thank you. I don't know why foreigners always choose a part, the part bamboozle, because this is China in 10 words, and we'll get back to those 10 words. Yeah. And he says, well, as we chose the part, he says, I don't know why foreigners always pick out this bamboozle part. But so, yes.
忽悠一词的迅速的风靡起来与山寨类似, 同样显示了当代中国社会伦理道德的缺失和价值观的混乱, 也是中国社会最近30年片面发展之后引发的后遗症之一, 而且忽悠现象在其社会生活方面的广泛性更甚于山寨现象, 当忽悠大行其道之时, 我们也就生活在了一个不认真的社会里, 或者说生活在一个不讲原则的社会里。 我的担心是, 当忽悠堂而皇之成为人们生活方式之时, 无论是一个人还是一个国家, 都有可能成为忽悠的受害者。 我的意思是说, 忽悠者最终很可能忽悠自己。 用中国的俗话说, 搬起石头砸了自己的脚。 我相信每个人都可能有过这样的经历, 想去忽悠别人, 到头来却是忽悠了自己。 我当然也不会例外啊, 然后就说我忽悠自己的故事了。 回首自己的忽悠往事, 我发现这样的经历为数不少, 在此举出一例。 我记忆里最初的忽悠对象是我的父亲。 当父亲要我去做什么时, 我又不愿意去做的时候, 或者我做错了什么时候, 父亲准备惩罚我的时候, 我常常利用假装生病的杠杆, 这在过去叫欺骗, 现在应该叫忽悠。 我想欺骗或者是忽悠父母, 可能是每一个孩子的天性。 那时候我已经上小学了, 我意识到父亲和我之间的美妙关系, 也就是说父亲是我的亲人, 即便我伤天害理, 他也不会置我于死地。 所以我最早的装病是从一个愚蠢的想法开始的。 现在我已经忘记了究竟是什么原因促使我装病, 我只记得是为了逃脱父亲对我的惩罚。 我假装发烧了, 摇摇晃晃地走向发怒的父亲, 去忽悠父亲。 父亲听完我对自己疾病的陈述后, 第一个反应, 似乎是不加思索的反应, 就是将他的手伸过来, 贴在我的额头上。 那时候我才想起来自己犯了一个致命的错误, 我竟然忘记了父亲是医生。 我心想完蛋了, 我不仅逃脱不了前面的惩罚, 还将面对新的惩罚。 很多年前写的, 念起来已经不那么流畅了啊。 幸运的是, 我的忽悠竟然蒙混过关。 当我父亲洞察秋毫的手, 意识到我根本没有发烧时, 他没有想到我是在忽悠他, 而是 对我整天不活动表示了极大的不满, 他怒气冲冲训斥我，警告我不能整天在家里坐着或者躺着，应该到外面去跑一跑，哪怕是晒晒太阳也好。接下去他明确告诉我，我什么病都没有，我的病是我不爱活动。然后他让我出门去，爱干什么就干什么，两小时以后再回来。我父亲的怒气因为对我身体的关心一下子转移了方向，使他忘记了我刚才的过错和他正在进行中的惩罚，突然给予了我一个无罪释放的最终裁决。我立刻逃出家门，然后在一个很远的安全之处站住脚，满头大汗地思索刚才的阴差阳错，是吧？思索的结果是以后不管出现什么危急的情况，我也不能假装发烧了。于是我有关疾病的表演深入到了身体内部，在那么一两年时间里，我经常假装肚子疼，确实起到了作用。由于我小时候对食物过于挑剔，所以我经常便秘，这在很大程度上为我的肚子疼找到了借口。每当我做错了什么事，我意识到父亲的脸正在沉下来的时候，我的肚子就会疼起来，条件反射。刚开始的时候我还能体会到自己是在装疼，后来竟然变成了条件反射，只要父亲一生气，我的肚子立刻会疼，连我自己都分不清这个疼痛是真是假。不过这对我来说已经不重要了，重要的是我父亲的反应。那时候我父亲的生气总会一下子转移到我对食物的选择上来，警告我如果继续这样什么都不爱吃的话，我面临的不仅仅是便秘，而是身体和大脑的成长都会深受其害。又是对我身体的关心使他忘记了我应该对我做出的惩罚。尽管他显得更加气愤，可是这类气愤由于性质的改变，我能够十分轻松地去承受。我装病的伎俩逐渐变本加厉，到后来不再是为了逃脱父亲的惩罚，开始为逃脱扫地啊或者拖地板这样的家务活而装病了。有一次我弄巧成拙，当我声称自己肚子疼的时候，我父亲的手摸到了我的右下腹，他问我是不是这个地方，我连连点头。然后我父亲又问我是不是胸口先疼，我仍然点头。接下去父亲完全是按照阑尾炎的病状询问我，而我全部点头。其实那时候我根本弄不清是真疼还是假疼，只是觉得父亲有力的手压到哪里，哪里就会发出疼痛，好像是父亲喊叫我的名字，我就会答应一样。然后在这一天的晚上，父亲把我背在了身上，走出家门。我懵懵懂懂地趴在父亲的背上，不知道接下去会发生什么。直到父亲背着我走进医院的手术室，我才预感到大事不妙了。当时我心里充满了迷茫。我父亲的坚定的神态使我觉得自己可能是阑尾炎发作了，可是我又想到自己最开始只是假装疼痛而已。尽管后来父亲的手压上来的时候真的是有点疼痛，我脑子里转来转去，不知道如何去应付接下来将要发生的事。父亲把我放在手术台上，我记得自己十分软弱地说一声我现在不疼了。父亲把我摁在手术台上，两个护士用手术台上的皮带把我的手脚绑住，我这时拼命挣扎起来，大声喊叫我现在不疼了。我希望他们会放弃已经准备就绪的手术，可是他们谁也没有理睬我，继续喊叫我要回家，让我回家。还没完，我以为完了呢。那时候我母亲是手术室的护士长，我记得她将一块布 盖在我的脸上，在我嘴的地方有一个口子，我就在这个口子里发出了声嘶力竭的喊叫声，表明我拒绝手术的决心。我的手脚被绑住了，只好扭动身体来加强自己的反抗。我听到母亲的声音，她让我不要喊叫，她警告我如果我继续喊叫我可能会噎死的。我吓了一跳，不明白为什么会喊叫会噎死。就在我停止喊叫思考这个复杂的问题时，发苦的那个麻醉粉末倒进了我的嘴里，没过多久我就什么都不知道了。等我醒来的时候，我已经睡在家里的床上了。我感到哥哥的头钻进了我的被窝，然后又立刻输了出去，连声喊叫他放屁了，臭死了。然后我看到父亲连声喊叫然后我看到父母站在床前，他们因为我哥哥刚才的喊叫而笑了起来。就这样我的阑尾被割掉了。而且当我还没有从麻醉里醒来的时候，我就已经放屁了。这意味着手术很成功，我很快就会康复。多年以后我曾经经询问过父亲，他当时打开我的肚子后看到阑尾是不是应该切掉，我父亲斩钉截铁地告诉我应该切掉。 我关心自己的阑尾当时是不是真的发炎了。父亲用模棱两可的语言语气回答，好像有一点红肿。我心想好像有一点红肿是什么意思？尽管父亲承认这好像有一点红肿就是不吃药也没有关系，但可是他坚持认为手术是最为正确的方案，因为对那个时代的外科医生来说，不仅是好像有一点红肿的阑尾应该切掉，就是完全健康的阑尾也不应该保留。我曾经相信父亲的话，不过现在我的看法和父亲不一样了，我认为这是自食其果。我本来是想忽悠父亲的，结果却是忽悠自己去挨了一刀。念完了，终于念完了。
That was a very nice excerpt, and I will just wait a sec until we're being joined by our interpreter. There he is. Yes, very good. So, actually.In this book, China in 10 Words, you talk about your own history and also about China's history. And this was the part that was called bamboozling, so to trick people. Would you say that bamboozling has become a national sport these days?
忽悠不仅在中国是个全民运动，在全世界都是运动。
So bamboozling is not just a national sport in China, but also a worldwide sport.
特朗普就一直在忽悠美国人民。
And Trump is bamboozling the whole world and the United States.
You write at the beginning of the book that the goal of this book is to compress the endless chatter of China today into 10 simple words. So it's divided in 10 chapters which talk about Yuhua's personal history and about the country as such. So it is a book about both him and the country. Still, the book has never been published in China.The first edition appeared in France, and then there were English and other editions, but why has it never been published in China?
其实我在写这本书的时候应该是2010年的时候，那时候还是中国的审查制度最为宽松的时候。
Has to be admitted that the moment when I write this book is around 2010. Frankly speaking, that period in China is supposed to be much tolerant period in terms of publication.
但是为什么不能出版？但是还是有一些禁区，比如说天安门事件是绝对不能写的。所以而这一部书的那个第一章《人民》里边写的就是天安门事件。嗯。
But there are still some sensitive topics. For example, the Tiananmen incident is forbidden. But in the first part of the 10 words, the China in 10 words, we will talk about the people. And that we mentioned a Tiananmen Square incident.
这本书的那个第一个版本是法语，在法国出版的。
As you mentioned, the first foreign edition is a French one. Was published in France.
然后我的很多书的那个第一个外文版都是法语。
In fact, a lot of my first foreign edition books are French one.
然后后来是应该是其他语言，就是英语啊或者其他的语言了。
Then the English translation, other language translation, so on and so forth.
我最早的时候我并不想出中文版，因为我想以后，我当时还相信将来总有一天我这本书能够在中国出版，所以我还想挣一点版税。
At that time, I had a small thinking that I thought, okay, maybe I delay a little bit the publication in Chinese. I can maybe earn more money when it could be published in China.
后来是因为那个有人知道我出了法文版、出了英文版，有这么一本书以后，我的朋友就给我写 email。希望我把那个中文的电子稿发给他们看一下啊。
And then I had a lot of friends who has came to know that my book has been translated to French and English. wrote me email that is it possible for you to forward us the electronic version of the Chinese manuscript.
然后我当然因为朋友想要看，你只能给他们，但是我告诉他们千万不要传给别人啊，在信里边。
Of course, their friends when they ask, I have to give them. But when I give them, I have to also remind that you can read, but please do not transmit it.
我相信我的朋友们看完以后也传给了他们的朋友，也会在 email 里边写，千万不要传给别人。
I believe that when my friend finished reading.They will naturally transmit to their friends, and they will add one sentence. Please do not transmit that to your friends.
然后有人告诉我，你那个书网上可以下载了。
And then suddenly one day, some people told me that your book can already be downloaded from internet.
吴雷就是从网上下载看的。
I downloaded from internet.
然后我赶紧去台湾出版。
So that's why I immediately go to Taiwan to make a Taiwan version.
要不再久的话，这本书没人出了。
Otherwise, nobody will publish because everything is online.
所以我觉得中国大家都知道，因为盗版是一个很严重的一个国家。它不仅是一个纸质书的盗版，还有一个电子书的盗版，还有一个网上的一种盗版。对。
As we all know, the intellectual piracy actually is a widespread problem in China. Not only in thehard copy, but also electronic one.
所以看待中国的盗版，你不能单纯的从那个知识产权的那个角度去看。
And we cannot directly equalize this unauthorized copy with intellectual property.
所以因为当一本书被禁止以后，它仅仅只是正式出版的上面被禁止，而盗版依然在流行。
So when a book is officially censored, it just means it has been forbidden on the legal level. Well, on the underground level, it's still circulating everywhere.
这是一方面。另一方面，我们中国虽然经济发展了那么的快，三十多年，但是我们依然有一个很庞大的一个贫穷人口。
Although we have to admit that although with the very quick economic development of China,we still have to look at the other side of China, where we have still a lot of poor people.
他们吃的食物可能不健康的，他们穿的衣服是最便宜的。
The food they eat may not be healthy, and the clothes they wear may not be of good quality.
所以，他们中间有一些人也想读书，但是没有钱去买正版的书，所以就用盗版。
Among these poor people, somewould like to go to school to have knowledge, but because of the poverty, they could not afford to have the original version of the book.
所以盗版有它在中国有它积极一面的意义。
It's just to say actually, the illegal copy, this phenomenon in China, still have some positive effect.
第一是让政府的禁止变得没有效果。
The first is to make the official and the governmental action of censorship invalid.
第二是可以让那些穷人的孩子们可以读到他们想要读的书。
Secondly, it give the chance for the poor kids to access to knowledge and news.
所以我在中国说我的书被盗版是应该的。
So that's why I say in China, I'm happy that my book has been copied illegally.
嗯。Of course, reading is one of these 10 words, and that brings me back to when you were a child, and where you recount that actually.There was a town hall with no more than 20 books. And of course, this was the Cultural Revolution. And so he started reading what they call poisonous weeds, foreign books, that had escaped the bonfires of the Cultural Revolution. So maybe you could talk to us about the first foreign novel you read and how you found out what the author was, because even that wasn't that simple, was it?
后是怎样去了解这个作家的名字的？
我读到的第一本那个，因为就是在文革的时候那个没有书，有一些书是被悄悄的被人保留下来，但是呢前面少了十多页，后面少了十多页，所以你不知道书名是什么，作者是谁，然后不知道故事怎么开始，也不知道故事怎么结束。
In the Cultural Revolution, there were actually no books and no foreign books as well. And there were some foreign books, novels, who had been accidentally kept, preserved, but in a very poor state. The beginning part lost, the ending part lost, so you don't know what's happening before and afterwards.
所以那个时候就读到了这样一本外国小说，里边有一些性描写，看得我心惊肉跳的。
Once I came across a foreign novel, and I remember there are a lot of description of a sexual part. When I was reading that, I feel very, very excited.
然后那个，而且在读的时候要看看，要听仔细听着周边有没有脚步声。有脚步声的话，赶紧把这书藏起来。
And also, when I was reading, I have to keep another attention that to fear that somebody else is passing by. If somebody else passing by, I have to hide the book in a secret place.
然后读完，我读完的时候，故事还没有结束，因为后面少了十多页。
So even I finished the book physically, but it's not yet finished because the ending part has been lost.
当时读过的所有的就是偷偷的在底下流传的小说都是这样，都是没有开头没有结尾。
All the underground novels, books from other country is in this kind of state, without beginning, without end.
不知道故事的开头，我的经验是不知道故事的开头是可以忍受的，但是不知道故事的结束实在是太难受了。
My reading experience told me that it's acceptable to read book without beginning, but it's hard to accept it a book without ending.
所以实在没办法，我只能自己去想那些故事的结尾。
So I was obliged to imagine the end of the story by myself.
想了一个又一个的结尾。
So I have to create different kind of endings by myself.
现在回忆起来，就是我在少年时期就已经训练自己的想象力了，已经。
So when I look back my writing career, actually I found accidentally I had already began training myself as a writer when I was an adolescent.
然后读到的刚才卡特琳娜说的那个我读到的第一部外国小说，大概到了文革结束以后，我们很多那个过去的文学作品及新的文学。国外的文学作品又翻译进来了，又重新出版，很多很多的出版了。
Actually, it is not until the end of Cultural Revolution that we have another wave of retranslation of the foreign books.
然后那个，我买了很多书，其中有一本是那个莫泊桑的《一生》。
I have purchased a lot of books, including one book by Guy Maupassant, The Life.
我读到三分之一的时候才发现这就是我当年读的第一部外国小说。
When I read until one third part of the book, I realized that, okay, this is the book I have read as the first book.
、it seems that your parents also had quite an interesting collection.Of books, medical books. Could you tell us about those?
能不能讲一讲这方面的故事？
因为那个时候，在文革的时候没有书可以读，所以非常的那个渴望读书。然后，但是我们家有一个小小的一个书架，上面放着，因为我父母都是医生，全是医学方面的书。
During Cultural Revolution, actually, there's a strong thirst for books. But at that time, actually, there's no books. Because my parents, they were doctors. So in my home, there's a small bookshelf. They have a lot of different kind of books about medication, about medicine.
然后到处找书找不着，只能读那个毛泽东选集四卷本的。
So we have to ransack everywhere for the books we really hope to read, but the only thing we can find is the anthology of Mao.
但是我后来发现毛泽东选集很好，很好，很有，当时很吸引我的一个原因是他的注解很有意思。
But what intrigued me in reading this anthology of Mao is that I found the footnotes were quite interesting.
所以我就天天拿着毛选在看注解，里边有历史人物，有历史故事。
So at that time, I always bring a book of Mao and read every day.And actually, I was reading the notebook, footnote, because they have a lot of explanations of the historical cultural allusions.
他们看那么一个孩子那么认真地学习毛泽东思想
，It was a very
都很钦佩我
very interesting image. All the adults looking at me as a kid, very small child, reading the anthology of Mao every day. But actually, I was reading just the footnote.
可是毛泽东选集的注解也读完了，那又没有书可以读了。
After finishing all the footnotes of Mao, there's again no book.
那个时候我记得我上初二，我哥哥上高二的时候，因为当时我父母是住在楼上，我和我哥哥是住在楼下，经常看到我哥哥带着他的同学跑到那个楼上，嘻嘻哈哈，发出一种奇怪的叫声。
At that time, I was the grade two in the junior middle school. Well, my bigger brother is grade two in a senior middle school. I remember very clearly that sometimes my brother will bring his friends, and I was living in the ground floor, my brother lived in the first floor. Sometimes I saw they were bringing the friends there and closed the door. I can hear from below that they would produce a very bizarre noise.
等到我听到声音以后，我上去以后，他们又若无其事，在那哈说别的话。可等到我下去以后，上面又发出怪叫了。
Then I came up to see what's happening. Then they will remain calm. Then I will go down. And once I went down, they will again produce this kind of very strange sound.
他几乎把他高中他那个年级的男同学全他妈带来了。
It seems that my big brother has brought.All the male students to the upstairs.
那个时候我就感觉到我父母的那个那些书里边肯定有秘密。
Then I suddenly realized there must be something secret in the books of my parents.
然后我开始去认真去寻找了。
Then I tried to search myself. What's the secret in the books?
在一本叫《人体解剖学》里边，有一张女性阴部的那个彩色图片。
Okay, finally, I found in a book, the name is Human Anatomy, and there's a color picture of a private part of female.
然后我把我那个年级的初中的男同学也全部带到我们家来了。
So what has happened afterwards is that all the male students from my grade, they all had the opportunity to come to my place.
也发出一阵阵的怪叫。
And those strange voice reproduced.
In the part that is about leaders, you explain, when I was a child, I thought that China was the greatest country in the world for two reasons. We had the greatest leader, because the other four great leaders, being Marx, Engels, Stalin, and Lenin, were all dead. And we had the most people. And Mao had said, the more people, the greater the strength. And then...You go on to explain that your own most lasting memories of Mao, you owe them to the ceiling of your house, because your father pasted layers of newspapers over the roof tiles to prevent dust and make the ceiling more presentable. So that is what Mao was to you, a prevention of leakage through the roof.
对，因为我们那个小的时候就是等于是，现在房子都是就是屋顶之间还有一层，我们当时没有，所以屋顶有我们需要用旧报纸给它糊上去。所以我的那个抬头一看，睡觉一看，我的那个满屋顶全是毛泽东啊。
Now, in the Chinese family, actually, there's a kind of a middle room between the roof and between the ceiling and the real roof. And previously we didn't have this kind of practice. So people used the newspapers to stick on the ceiling. And I had an memory that when I lie down, look upstairs, is all the picture, all the things related to Mao.
最早站在那个毛身边的是刘少奇，后来再看看边上那个站的刘少奇那个位置变成了林彪。嗯、
the earliest, in the earliest newspapers, the people closest to Mao is Chairman Liu Shao Qi. And then if you look at other parts of the newspaper, you see, okay, later Liu Shao Qi has been replaced by Lin Biao.
反正毛身边的人物不断的在变化，就他自己没变。
In a word, all the people around Mao has been changed except himself.
因为很多在他身边的人一个一个被打倒了。
Because all the people close to Mao has been kind of washed off one by one.
前段时间我在网上看到那个林彪，他对毛泽东的，他做了一些笔记，他专门研究毛泽东。他对毛泽东有一个评价，我觉得我相信是林彪写的。
Not long ago, I read a material or document. It's Lin Biao who has the habit of documenting the behavior of Mao. And according to my reading, I think it should be Lin Biao who has documented that.
毛泽东在想清除他不喜欢的人的时候，他用的方法就是编造这个人提了一个什么意见，其实这个人根本就没有提过意见，然后在会上反驳他的意见，最后把他给打成反革命分子。
So according to this document written by Lin Biao, Mao has a strategy to wash off the people around him. The first, the thing is to, he would first invent the opinion.By these people, and then in a public meeting, he will defend himself and retort against this invented opinion, and then mobilize the people to go against these people.
Yes. Actually, I mean now, Mr. Yuhua is probably, if we leave Moyan out of it, who won the Nobel Prize, you're probably the most famous.Writer of your country, whereas actually it didn't at all start out like that. If things had gone smoothly, or if you did not try anything else, you would have been a dentist for the rest of your life. And as you put it yourself, looking at the world's most unattractive scenery for 8 hours a day, extracting in total at least 10,000 teeth.But something said to you, this, I'm 20 years old, this is not what I want for my life. So how did you set out to change that? Because of course the profession of being a dentist had not been chosen, but had been, it was the job that he was given. At that time the state was still deciding what your profession would be, so he had become a dentist. So,How did you get out of looking into people's mouth for 8 hours a day?
是怎么样促使你不再去从事这个一天八个小时给人
打这个行业？因为在八十年代那个时候，就是我当牙医那个时候，那个中国一个人是没有权利找工作的，只有政府给你什么工作，你就得去做什么工作。
In the 1980s.At that time in China, individual had not the right to choose job, to find a job. Actually, all the jobs are given by the government.
然后那个这个牙医是政府给我的，不是我想要的。
Actually, I have to say, being a dentist is not my choice. I have been chosen to be a dentist.
然后我非常的，确实是非常的不喜欢那份工作。
Frankly speaking, I really hate this job.
每天看着别人张开的嘴巴，这是我的形容啊。 我的青春就是在别人的嘴巴里看着别人的嘴巴度过的。
My youth is spent in looking at somebody else's mouth every day.
当我那个回忆青春的时候，全是张开的嘴。
So when I try to think about my youth, it's all those opening of mouths.
那个时候我就发现，我们县那个文化馆工作那些人，整天在大街上游玩。我就问他们：“你们为什么不工作？”他们说：“我们在大街上走来走去就是工作。”我想这工作我也很喜欢，是吧？
I still remember the people working in the cultural center of my hometown, the small town, and their job actually was just loafing around the street. And I really envy them. And if it is your job, I would like to have your job.
然后那个，我心想怎么能够调到文化馆去工作
？That's why I try different ways to change my job to the culture center of the village.
然后就开始写小说，只要小说发表了就可以调到文化馆去工作了。
So I found a way that's writing. If you can write good novels.That prove that you are capable of going to work in the culture center.
很顺利，那个小说写了以后就发表了。
It turns out to be much easier, and once I finish a novel, and it's published.
然后就调到文化馆去工作。
Then I went to the culture center to work.
有意思的是，我第一天上班故意迟到，迟到大概有两个小时。
I was intentionally late on the first day of my work.
结果发现我是第一个来上班的。
Only to find that actually I was still the first to arrive.
我这一次的欧洲之行到过都灵，然后又让我回想起我们1998年1月份的时候，我们有四个作家，去都灵参加一个活动。对。
And this time in my tour in Europe.I passed Turin in Italy. It reminds me my first trip with other four Chinese writers in 1998 in the same city.
然后，我们那个题目就是我为什么写作，就是当时那个都灵的那个意大利都灵的那个题目。
At that time, we have a topic: why we write.
然后，完了以后是莫言说了，莫言是他为什么写作呢？因为他以前是当兵的。
The first was Mo Yan, and Mo Yan explained actually he used to be a soldier.
他当的是哨兵，就站在那一个军营的门口站岗的。
His exact job is a sentry, who is standing at the entrance of the camp, the military camp, to keep an eye of the people coming in and going out.
他站了几年下来，发现。军官全是穿皮鞋的，士兵全是穿球鞋的。
And after years of performing this job of sentry, Mo Yan discovered that all the officers they wear leather shoes, while all the soldiers they wear those kind of canvas shoes.
他特别想拥有一双皮鞋，可是没有钱。
And the direct reason was Mo Yan really wished to have a pair of leather shoes, but he didn't have money.
然后怎么办呢？写小说，发表了就可以拿到稿费，就可以去买一双皮鞋了。
And for Mo Yan, writing a novel became a way to get himself out from this kind of a strange situation, so that he can have money to buy a pair of leather shoes.
然后他就这样走上了文学道路。
And this is Mo Yan's raison d'être to be a writer.
第三个发言的是王朔。
The second people who explained this question is Wang Shuo.
他呢也当兵，是海军，在一个仓库里边工作，海军的仓库里边工作。
At that time, Wang Shuo remember actually when he was young, he was also a soldier. He was a soldier in sea. How to say?
Navy.
Yeah, he was working in a work.仓库怎么说 ？Warehouse。
他边上是一个海军的医院，医院里面的护士一个比一个漂亮。
And very close to this warehouse, were this military hospital where there were a lot of very charming nurses.
那个时代的那个那个漂亮的姑娘基本上都在部队医院里。
In fact, during that period, we have to admit that all the very beautiful ladies, they work in the military hospital.
王朔非常想去那个医院当一名宣传方面的干部。
And Wang Shuo really wants to become a kind of officer in this kind of hospital, in charge of propaganda.
然后他就想写小说，发表了以后就可以去那个医院，然后去和那些漂亮护士谈恋爱。
So for Wang Shuo, writing became a possible way to get to those kind of hospital and to talk about romance with all these charming ladies.
然后他也这样走上了文学道路。
And this is the raison d'être of writer for Wang Shuo.
因为我们三个都没有上过大学啊。
And all of us, Wang Shuo, Mo Yan, and me, we haven't a chance to go to a college.
只有第四个苏童是上过大学的。
The fourth one is Su Tong. He had the opportunity to receive higher education.
苏童最纯洁，他就说他到了大学以后如何热爱文学，然后走上了文学道路。
And except us, we have different reasons. 苏童 's attachment to literature was the purest. He said, because I went to the college and I have a strong desire for literature.
他听了我们三个人念完以后，他都不敢念他的那个发言稿了。
So Su Tong was the last to explain why he became a writer, and after hearing all ofThe first three writers explained their different reasons to be a writer, and Su Tong was a little bit embarrassed.
他很羞愧。
It was a kind of guilty.
我跟他说应该是我们三个人羞愧，你是走的是正道是吗？
I comforted Su Tong that actually it should be us three who should feel guilty instead of you, because you are following a right way.
然后他的回答是我太愚蠢了，我怎么会这么写？
And Su Tong responded that actually I was so foolish. How could I write that I have the strong, pure, lofty literature desire? I shouldn't write this way.
Right. Another of your words is disparity. China is very much a place of great disparity. And as Yuhua writes,China today is like walking down a street where on this side are gaudy pleasure palaces and on that side desolate ruins. When asked two children, urban and rural, what they wanted, and the Beijing boy wanted a Boeing jet for himself, and the girl, rural, wanted a pair of sneakers. So what to do with that?Actually, I was wondering, seeing this disparity being there, indeed, what is your personal opinion? How could this be resolved?
The gap between the rich and poor is actually increasing instead of eliminating.
这也是那个导致那个社会，目前中国社会并不是像表面上看的那么的那个稳定，的一个重要原因。
This is the important reason why China is actually not so prosperous, essentially.
所以，现在有人把这个责任推到了邓小平头上去了，说是因为改革开放，所以才形成差距。
Now a lot of people would say it's Deng Xiaoping's fault for the whole people to have this kind of problem, rich and poor. But it should not be think like this way.
所以，但是你要知道，当一个社会经济一旦发展起来的话，自然而然就是那个贫富差距会越来越大。
We should look at the question this way.As long as the economy develops in one region, it's natural to have this disparity between the rich and poor.
但是从目前来看的话，我们那个的各个地方的政府以及上面就各级政府，对于那个贫富差距，它三十多年来，它好像给我感觉它根本就没有当回事。
But according to my observation, different levels of government in China.Haven't paid any attention to this kind of a gap between the rich and poor.
他只是嘴上说说要解决这个问题，但他很少有实际的行为。
They just talk. This is a question to be resolved, a problem to be resolved. But actually, in action, there's nothing.
因为中国政府是一个强有力的政府，他要是一开始就关注这个问题，而且用一种正确的方式去那个去处理的话，我们的贫富差距不会像现在那么大。
In fact, we know the government of China is very powerful. If they could have resolved the question, pay attention to this question from the beginning, we could not have such a big disparity between rich and poor as now.
So then, of course, why didn't they?
那为什么不对这个贫富差距？
If you say they did have the power, why didn't they do it?
他们关注的是高速发展。经济发展，然后他们就他们这是他们的政绩，嗯。
And the Chinese political culture is mainly the meritocracy. All the government officials they only pay attention to the economic development, and this would be considered as their achievement to go higher in the political hierarchy.
But when you talk about disparity, at the same time.And that's, of course, this irony which always comes back, and that sarcasm. Then you talk about the rich list. There's a rich list in China which is made up of all the richest people. And you say the rich list is a pigs for slaughter list. Because there's a Chinese saying, people fear getting famous just as pigs fear getting fat. Because fame...invites a fall, just as a fattened pig invites the butcher. Could you explain that to us?
那要看是什么样的富人。假如你是像马云啊或者马化腾这样，他们上不上无所谓，因为他们的那个互联网帮助他们起来的时候是不需要政府帮忙的。
It depends what kind of rich people we're talking about. For those already the internet tycoon in China, like Ma Yun, Jack Ma, or Ma Huateng, they don't have to care if they are on the list or not, because when they begin to develop internet industry, and the government didn't have a interfere in their kind of career building.
但是那些依靠那个跟政府的官员的关系开始做生意那些人，他们当然不愿意上。
But for those another kind of rich people whose richness was built upon those kind of liaison with the government officials or the red tapes with the government officials, they really have this kind of fear to be listed in the rich list.
但是还是有不少人想上这个富豪榜，因为他们觉得很骄傲。
But still, a lot of people wish to get exposed, to get enlisted in this kind of a rich people list, because for them it's kind of privilege.
对，很多聪明的人都不想上，但是有些，不是那么聪明的人，他们反而是想上。
We should say clever people, they try to avoid being in the list. Well, some other foolish people, they try struggle to be part of the list.
从现在到现在为止的形势来看，那些很聪明的不想上的人被抓走的比上的还要多。
But the reality told us those clever people who try different ways to avoid being in the list actually turn out to be caught more than the people who are on the list because of the corruption, because of different kind of illegal practice.
所以在共产党面前，你聪明也好，不聪明也好，都逃不过他的眼睛。
So before the eyes of the Communist Party, there actually is no difference of rich and poor. And if you are on the list or off the list, it doesn't make a difference.
Right. Another word, of course, that has to appear is copycat. And you talk about copycat interviews, people who said they spoke with you and published articles and actually you'd never met them. And in the end, you're saying, well, actually, I now consider myself a copycat dentist. Of course, if I mean, looking at all of that from a Western perspective, there's been enormous amount of protest concerning the non-respect of intellectual property laws, all of that. So, you've already talked about the illegal copies of your own books and saying that it was a good thing that poor kids could still read them. But what do you think yourself of that whole copycat culture?
The copy actually is already an old phenomenon in China. Basically, it's to copy others' ideas and to sell and to make money.
它经历了一个过程, 首先是粗制滥造, 然后把这个产品化, 就在全国销售,
There's different levels of copycat practice. The first, the earliest phase is, okay, you just copy in a very general way, in a very, well, not realistic way, and then you copy the idea and you sell nationwide.
然后他们越做越好, 做得比原来的还好。
But when it developed, those people who copy, they copy the things in a more refined way. And sometimes it could be much refined than the original version.
然后我十多年以前我曾经问过一个 LV 在中国的一个代表, 我说如何来区分那个 LV 这个包的那个, 是真的还是假的?
One decade ago, I had a chance to talk with a representative of Louis Vuitton in China. Ask him a question. How would you differentiate the real Louis Vuitton and the fake one?
然后他告诉我，质量好的那个是假的，质量不好的那个是真的。
And the answer is, the good quality one is fake. The not good quality one is the real.
然后中国的山寨再继续往前走，你比如说刚才我们说到的那个马化腾，他的那个腾讯，他的所有之前的所有的互联网产品，全部是山寨的。 学那个美国的,
And now in China we have Ma Huateng, internet tycoon, and who has a business called Tencent, very famous. And if you look at his earlier career, actually his products, internet products, were all copied from United States.
然后我们山寨之后，我们已经开始超过美国了，已经。
And now after this period of copy, and now the internet industry in China has already passed. United States.
And
not long ago, I watched the interview of Jim of Thomas of Cook, the CEO of Apple. He was receiving an interview from in China. He was so much amazed by China's third-party payment, internet payment. He was really amazed by the development of the internet industry in China.
那个你现在在中国的一些一线的城市，你出门的话，不用带现金，不用带信用卡，拿一个手机，一切都没问题。
In China, in the first level cities, and if you just go out with a mobile phone, you can settle all the things with this mobile phone.
你只要扫一下那个二维码就付钱了。
You just scan. QR codes, and then you are paying. You are, yeah, it's true, yeah.
然后出现了乞丐，身上挂一个二维码，因为他们都没零钱了，扫一下，给个几块钱，十块钱，二十块钱，嗯。
There are also this kind of QR beggars, and they will put a QR code before their chest, and people passing by can just swipe. their codes, and then you are giving out money to the beggars.
所以现在美国的那些，在美国的湾区，在美国的硅谷，他们有些人开始感叹。 中国已经超过我们了。
A lot of people in the United States, a lot of people working in a Silicon Valley, they actually realize that actually China is picking up and China is going to be much more advanced than us technologically.
Right. You've spoken in the piece which you've written for all the audience today about the difference between Chinese and foreign readers. Could you maybe read a small excerpt out of that? And Mr. Wu, could you man the machine? And after that, you get a chance to ask questions, okay?
You don't have to stay here, just stay here.文学是包罗万象的，当我们在文学作品里读到有三个人正在走过来，有一个人正在走过去时已经涉及到了数学，三加一等于四。当我们读到唐在热水里融化时已经涉及到了化学，当我们读到树叶掉落下来时已经涉及到了物理，文学连数理化都不能回避，又怎能去回避社会和政治？但是文学归根结底还是文学。 无论是在中国还是在外国，读者最为关心的仍然是人物命运、故事等这些属于文学的因素。只要是谈论小说本身，我觉得国外读者和国内读者提问没有什么区别，存在的区别也只是这个读者和那个读者的区别。当我们中国读者阅读外国文学作品时，吸引我们的是什么？很简单，就是文学。我曾经说过，假如文学里真的存在神秘的力量，那就是让读者在不同时代、不同民族、 不同文化、不同历史的作家的作品中读到属于自己的感受。在和国外读者交流时，常常会出现轻松的话题，比如会问在中国举办这样的活动和在国外举办这样的活动有什么不同。就像今天的活动啊，我告诉他们，中国人口众多，中途退场的人也比国外来的全部的人要多得多啊。还有一个问题是我会经常遇到。 与读者见面印象最深的是哪一次？我说是1995年第一次出国去法国，在圣马洛文学节的一个临时搭起的大帐篷里面签名售书，坐在一堆自己的法文版书后面，看着法国读者走过去走过来，其中有人拿起我的书看了看，又放下走了。左等右等，终于来了两个法国小男孩，他们手里拿着一张白纸。 通过翻译告诉我，他们没有见过中国字，问我是不是可以给他们写两个中国字。这是我第一次在国外签名，当然我没有写自己的名字，我写下了中国。Thank you, thank you. I was wondering when you're writing. Do you think of the reader, any reader? Well,
actually, it's very hard to imagine a readership. If you write for specifically some people, you may think of them, but if you write a large readership, it's really hard for you to think about them.
因为如果你有几万个读者，你真的不知道他们想要看到什么东西啊。
Since if you have to face tens of thousands of readers, it's really hard for you to imagine what they really want.
但是要知道每一个作家同时他自己也是读者。
But at the same time, we have to conscious that every writer is himself a reader.
所以当我们在写作的时候，这是我的体验。当我在写作的时候，突然感觉到这一段写的有问题的时候， 那就是我作为一个读者的身份在发言了。嗯。
My experience told me sometimes when I write, sometimes I feel it difficult to continue. Actually, I realize that actually it's the voice of me as a reader who remind me that there's something goes wrong.
所以写作，一个作家在写作时他有双重身份，作者的身份是让那个叙述在推进，读者的身份是在把握分寸，进行修改。
We have to bear in mind of the duality of the role of writer. On the one hand, is the writerly writer who push the plot, while on the other hand, is the readerly writer who reminds you and who controls the development of the plot.
所以如果说我要为某一个读者写作的话，那只能为我自己。
So if there would be a reader I have to write for, it should be myself.
我自己的判断力，我自己的感受力，决定了这部自己的写作是不是在朝着一个正确的方向进前进。嗯。
I, as a reader, have to use my own, like a judgment, my own sensation, to decide how and where to write.
Thank you. So I was wondering, we still have like.Almost 10 minutes. Should you have any questions, feel free to ask. Yes? And you can ask your question both in Chinese or in English, and they will then be, of course, translated for the rest of the audience.
喂，于老师你好，很高兴第一个机会提问。我想问的问题呢，是写东西啊，看上去是很简单的一个事，每个人都可以写，但是只有非常少的人可以成为作家。您认为一般人写东西跟作家他写东西有什么区别吗？以及这个想成为一个作家这个事是天赋多一点还是后天的训练会多一点呢？谢谢您。
So first question, translate.
The question is, is there any difference between a non-writer writer and a writer writer? And is there what play a more important role in writing? Is the kind of this kind of intuition as a poet, as a writer, or is kind of later training, which is more important to be successful writer?
天赋是什么？天赋有时候其实就是一种运气，啊，就是一个人他是否找到了一份最适合他从事的工作。如果找到了，他的天赋自然出来了；如果找不到，再有天赋也出不来。
So when we talk about this kind of intuition or talent, it's actually could be reinterpreted as a luck. If you do what you can, it means you have this luck, and you don't have to wait for talent. The talent will come spontaneously. Otherwise, it would be very difficult. You cannot show your talent.
所以，有的人可能他的天赋就是在写作。另外一些人的天赋是在发明创造其他的东西，还有一些人的天赋可能就是在从事一些组织活动，所以不同的天赋会在不同的工作中表现出来。
Different people have different talent. Some people are talented writing stories. Some others may be talented producing or inventing different kind of products.While other people may be talented in organizing, coordinating events. So different people may have their own talent in different aspects.
所以这里边需要很大成分是需要运气的。
We really depend on luck so that our talent can have a chance to play itself.
有些人可能在自己的工作领域已经取得了 成就。他可能自己认为自己找到了一份适合自己的工作，其实未必。他如果从事另外一份呢，很可能成就伟大的成就，是吗？
Some people they may have already achieved a certain accomplishment in their career, and they thought they comfort themselves that maybe this is the place where I can show my talent, but it's not necessarily so. Probably if they change another.Profession, change another job, they can do a much bigger thing.
就是一个作家，我已经成为一个作家了。 我在什么时间写下什么作品也是一种运气。
Even for an established writer, it still depends on the luck, at what specific moment to write what specific work. It's something we have to depend on our luck.
所以假如我是在一个最适合写这部作品的时候写这部作品，这部作品肯定写得很好。
Other words, if I write a book, at the right moment, the book has to be naturally successful.
科学也一样。
Science also.
也会遇到突然遇到什么情况下运气来了，让他看到了什么。
It's also the same thing for science. If you discover the thing at the right moment, you have the luck. Otherwise, no.
至于要写作的话，如果你要想写作的话，没有别的办法，只有一个字，写，不断的写，才能够写出来。
The only way to distinguish yourself in writing is to keep on writing.
这就好比你的人生，你要经历，经历，不断的去经历什么，你才知道自己的人生是什么样的。
It's exactly as the life. You have to try different ways to experience your life in order to know what is life.
Yes. 于老师您好，我在欧洲呢生活了几年，发现呢很多这个西欧人啊对中国的认知啊，不是那么的全面。那么您参加这样的一个就是读友会啊，然后跟这个广大的国外读者这样一个互动，在多大程度上能够改变他们对中国的一个认知？那您这样的一种互动活动，对促进这个双边的这种民间的这种了解，有多大的推动作用？谢谢。
没什么作用，我觉得。
And the gentleman actually is a journalist, and he say actually after spending some years in Europe, I found that actually most of the European people don't really have a thorough or comprehensive understanding of China. The question is when Mr. Yu Hua come here to have this kind of interaction with the readers, and to what extent you would expect this kind of interaction would change the perception of the European people about China? And the answer is simple. There's no possibility to change their perception of China.
基本上没什么作用。
Almost impossible.
Yes. There were two... Yes. Yes, go ahead.
En français aussi, bonsoir. J'ai adoré votre livre, Brothers, c'est pour moi un chef-d'œuvre.
Très bien, c'est un chef-d'œuvre, c'est un chef-d'œuvre.
Je vais en Chine assez régulièrement et j'aime beaucoup votre pays. Je me permets de vous poser une question. J'ai lu d'autres de vos livres, mais d'abord, je vois un film extraordinaire avec Brothers.Mais surtout, je voudrais vous demander, je vous ai vu à Europe, à l'IA, il y a quelques années. Je vous ai même à un moment parlé, mais surtout ce qui me frappe, et je me permets de vous poser cette question tout en admirant beaucoup votre œuvre, vous avez un regard plus triste depuis aujourd'hui. Est-ce que ça va changer votre littérature ou est-ce que votre vie, quelque part,
他说发现今天您这个整个状态，那个好像比较痛苦，就是从看着这个整个就是看着不好意思，就是米歇尔最早是在2009年欧罗巴利亚艺术节的时候见到过，在布鲁塞尔见到过余华老师，然后呢那个也非常喜欢余华老师作品《兄弟》。然后也经常去中国，然后他的问题可能就是比较他说从今天开始见到余华老师和上次见的感觉不一样，因为感觉余老师在这次好像
要原话就是看着好像状态比较痛苦，眼神比较痛苦。想问问是发生了什么事情？是家里发生什么事情，还是自己发生了什么变故了？想了解一下。
我在8月12号突然病了一场，就头剧烈的疼痛，然后在杭州住院了5天，又住院期间又疼了一次，后来我还是出院，因为我要去丹麦，然后我就出院以后回到北京又剧烈的疼痛，杭州的5天检查出来说是没有问题，就是血管性的头痛。
Yes, and in fact, I had a sudden attack of headache on August the 12th in Hangzhou. Then I was immediately hospitalized in 5 days, and the doctor tried to diagnose and find actually there's no specific reason. But because I would have to go to Denmark for another exchange, so I get out of the hospital immediately. But when I go to Beijing, and this attack came again, so headache.
结果在去丹麦的前一个晚上又发病了，所以我就没有去。
So just one day before going to Denmark, this headache come again. So that prevent me from going to Denmark.
然后我在北京的医院里边又查了半个月，还是查不出毛病来。
I spent another fortnight in Beijing, in a very good hospital, to see with the doctor what's the reason, and there's no specific reason.
但是9月5号他们告诉我，我的医生告诉我说你可以去欧洲了。今天是我欧洲的最后的一个活动。所以你的眼睛很厉害，一方面我是生过病，第二方面我确实有点疲惫了。
It's not until the September 5th, my doctor finally agreed that I can go to Europe. Then I come to this, this trip. And you are very sharp in your eyes, because on one hand I had headache. The other hand, after several weeks here in Europe,I feel very tired. This is the last day here in Europe. Tomorrow I will go back to China.
Yu 老师您好。
No.
我不说中文。So. you have been translated, it seems, more than 30 different languages, and as you might know, as you know, of course.One language is one different point of view on the word. And so I was wondering how you were working with your translators, if you were just blindly trusting them, or if you had a really strong relationship when they were working and translating you, or if there were several anecdotes on different complicated things to translate into Danish or French or English. 谢谢。
不同的国家不一样，比如我在法语我就是两个翻译，他们今天来专门来看我了，我们一直在我那个文章里面也已经写了朋友，对。
There are translators and translators. For example, in France, I have two very good translator friends. Both of them are here among the audience. I really have a very strong relationship and strong friendship, deep friendship with them.
然后我的荷兰语的那个翻译知道我要到荷兰，他跑到中国的云南去了，
well,
就是不想见我。
On the other hand, my Dutch translator, he knows very well that I'm coming here to Europe, but he went to 云南 in China to avoid.
他去研究中国的道教去了。
He went to 云南 to study the Taoism.
但是我对他这种行为我一点都不生气，我觉得完全可以理解。
But I fully understand his choice.
我为此还给他提了一个研究的一点小素材。
I even propose a research direction for him.
我说我曾经问过一个很大的一个道观的道长，在我们杭州玉皇山上面的。
I had a chance actually to talk with a Taoist, very high level Taoist monk in Hangzhou, my hometown.
因为道教是我们的那个中国的国教，佛教是从印度传过来的。
As you know,
Taoism is the indigenous religion in China. Well, Buddhism actually is only imported from India.
所以我就告诉他，我说我问过一个道长，为什么在中国，道教远不如佛教？远远不如佛教。
I talked to this the high level Taoist monk, and asked the question why Taoism in China.Is less influential, much less influential than Buddhism.
然后那个道长告诉我，佛教有钱，道教没钱。
The reply from this Taoist monk is that the Buddhists have money, while the Taoists are poor.
然后我韩国的翻译现在我都不认识，全是出版社找的。
Well, the translators from Korean translators actually are all designated by the publishing house. I have no relation with them. But they just translate according to the order of publishing house.
有些语言是从英文转译过去的，所以根本没法跟他们说话。
And some of the Korean translation actually was adapted from English translation. In this respect, I have even further distance with them.
Which country for a Chinese is in Europe is most interesting to learn to know the culture of Europe?
您觉得对对这个您的角度来看，所有这些欧洲国家里边，哪个是最值得中国人去了解的，去借鉴的？哪个国家的文化？哪个欧洲？
啊，一般人都会回答是法国。对
，normally.The response will be France.
我觉得法国它开放，它真的是非，它具有一种开放性。
First and foremost, France represents the openness.
因为作为一个中国作家来说，我觉得在法国出书最容易。
Because as a Chinese writer, it appears to be very easy to publish in France.
美国最保守，最难。
On the contrary, United States is supposed to be the most reserved country in the world.
九十年代的时候，一个美国的著名的翻译家告诉我一个数据，弄得我很自卑，觉得在美国不可能出书了。
In the 1990s, American translator ever gave me a statistics of the publishing phenomenon in the United States.
他说是一万个读小说的那个美国读者里边，只有一个读外国小说。
He told me that among 10,000 American readers, only one read foreign novels.
一万个读外国小说的人里面，只有一个读中国小说。
And among 10,000 Americans who read foreign novels, there's only one who read Chinese novels.
在法国不是这样。
It's a totally different picture in France.
当然，我最后发现美国也不是这样，也不像他们说的那么可怕。美国还是。还是有它的优势。
But later I found that actually, in the United States, not so much closed. Actually, still people tend to read foreign novels a lot.
Okay, I think we'll have to leave it at this. Thank you very much.